I'd like to let our audience know that Dr. Tour is also involved in a lot of research, a lot of real positive research. Rice University is known for this, and Dr. Tour is at the forefront of it. And Dr. Tour, could you quickly comment on one of your recent projects you're working on? And this is from a headline, cancer cells destroyed, vibrating molecules achieve 99% destruction in lab study. Is that something you have time to elaborate on?
Yeah, this was one of the postdocs working in my group. He came up with a new concept. We've been working on molecular machines for years. We first put them in little cars to push the cars along. And then in 2017, we published a paper where we took these little nanomachines that you excite with light, and those were excited with ultraviolet light, and then they would drill into cells. And then we moved to a visible light where we could then activate them. The big question was, could we have a molecule working in the near-infrared region? Because near-infrared light passes through the body very well. So in other words, you could get 5 or 10 centimeters of penetration through the human flesh. So now you could really go after diseases that were deep inside the body using a near-infrared light activation. So he came up with a molecule that does that. So these molecules will interface with a cell. They'll insert into the lipid bilayer of the cell. And then you shine a light on it from outside the body, and the molecule will start vibrating. It vibrates at a million vibrations per second. So that's a million vibrations per second. And it's like a little sonicator. It liquefies the lipid bilayer of the cell. The cell explodes and dies. And so we've used that now to address cancer and we're moving it into superbacteria and we've used it. We're moving it into other modes of treatment, but that's what that is about. These are little nanomachines that are activated to either spin or vibrate when they get hit with light. And this is a specific wavelength of light and a specific intensity. It's not like the sunlight can do this.
Wow. That's how far along are you? I know that the approval process would, you know, take a long time. Are you making headway as far as getting something like this where it's ready, you know, for the public to use? I know that could be years out, unfortunately, with the way things can move slowly. But how's that aspect of it coming along?
Yeah, it is years out. We have done all the mouse experiments on melanoma, which is skin cancer. We're now moving into pancreatic cancer, which is a particularly deadly form, very, very quick acting type of cancer. And there's reasons for that, because you can't do surgery on a tumor that's in the head of the pancreas, because you have a main artery there that runs right through the middle of it. And you can't use sufficient radiation because you destroy the duodenum, which is right behind it. And so we're working on that type of cancer. And it's probably the mouse experiments are going on now, the experiments in rodents. And there is a company, we've started a company around this, and they're supposed to be pushing this from the medicinal end to push it onto the market. But okay. That's out of my hands. Once it gets in the company, their work is, I'm separate from that.
Gotcha. Is there any way that our listening audience can help? Is there like, you said there's a company, or is there any other, you know, maybe some kind of, you know, financial help of any kind?
Let me put it out there that many people have seen this, and they you know, they have cancer and they want to donate themselves for treatment. It's not even to that point yet. Let me put it in perspective. From a lab finding until something is on the market, it's generally 12 to 14 years. Even with right to try, when there's it's still going to be 4 to 5 years from so even in a case where a person has no other solution to their treatment, it could be 4 or 5 years. The company, the name of the company is called Nanorobotics, and they're certainly in fundraising mode. But again, I'm not an officer or director of the company, and it's a conflict of interest for me to talk about mm-hmm. that in that sense. Okay. So yeah. I have no control over the company, and they're trying to push that along themselves. And if some of your listeners are believers in the Lord, you can certainly pray that the Lord continues to give wisdom and push this thing along. And if you're interested in contacting that company, the company's name is Nanorobotics, and you can contact them. But that don't go through me for that, because I try to be separate, or else for me it becomes a conflict of interest.
So Dr. Tour, is there any other research that you would like to share with us that you're involved in that's really neat about these vibrating molecules to help solve, you know, what could be really serious cancer? Pancreatic is obviously one of the worst, but do you have other research you're involved in right now?
We've actually started 14 companies in the last 9 years. And one of the big efforts that we have is around something called flash joule heating. And through this, we were able to convert any carbon material. The vast majority of what we throw out in our homes, 85-90% of it is carbon-based. If it's not glass and it's not metal, it is carbon. And we can take any carbon material, whether it be waste food, trash, coal, petroleum coke, whatever it may be, and we can put it between two electrodes with high voltage and convert it into graphene. Graphene is single atomic sheets of graphite, different layers of this single atomic sheets of graphite that allow that can be put in composite materials. It's very lightweight, super strong. And so this is going into asphalt markets, going into parking lots of just outside the building where this is being demonstrated. But it can triple the life of an asphalt road. It's going into concrete. It's going into plastic composites, and it's going into rubber tires to strengthen the rubber tires. And graphite is already known in the world. It's just that we didn't have access to these single atomic sheets. Graphite is part of our world, so it's not like we're introducing a totally new type of material. Around this, we also have a company that's also able to convert waste plastic into graphene or waste plastic into carbon nanotubes that are also going to be used to enhance electrodes and be used in composites. And then we're using a similar technology to clean up the environment, where we can put electrodes into the ground to remove contaminants such as heavy metals, such as oil products, and such as PFAS. This is poly and perfluorinated alkyl substances, which are contaminating a lot of our water systems. So we've learned how to degrade that. We can take old wind turbines, old aircraft, which were normally just landfilled. Those are made out of glass and carbon mixed together, glass, plastic, or carbon fiber and plastic. And we flash those. That turns into silicon carbide, which has many uses as an enhancement material. It's a very hard material. And so we're trying to take the waste that people generate, electronic waste is the fastest growing waste in the world, what we do with our cell phones, what we do with our devices, what we do with our car batteries, and we're learning how to recycle all of those, and not just recycle, but also upcycle, make them more valuable through these techniques. And at very low energy, the amount of energy we have to put in, say, to take coal and turn it into graphene is about $30 per ton. It's one of the cheapest manufacturing routes you could even think of. So we have all of these going, the electronic waste, we're pulling out all the metals, because metals should be, in theory, infinitely recyclable. And so we just throw them out and we do more mining, and then we throw it out, we do more mining. But can we just take this waste, all these printed circuit boards that you guys generate in your company that are toxic waste, and server farms get rid of them every 3 years. We flash them, we get all the metals out, and now we're learning how to separate the metals one by one, bring them out with different flashing units and different flashing parameters. And then what's left over is clean enough to be agricultural soil in the state of California. So it's going to be a great advance for humankind, I think.
Oh, that's fantastic. So I know this would have been music to the ears of my co-host, Doug, who unfortunately had to drop off because of technical difficulties. But he actually researched graphene, and we did a show on it, Dr. Tour, some time ago that we'll link to. But that's really cool that you found a low cost, a low energy, because a lot of times power can be a real problem, the expense of power. And it sounds like you're able to do this, you know, without expending a lot of energy. That's a huge plus in itself. We just had a guest last week, Dr. Tour, or 2 weeks ago, talking about artificial intelligence and the enormous amount of power that you need to make that thing work. I mean, it much more than like the salaries you pay all the engineers working on it. So the fact that you can do this at the power that you just mentioned, that's incredible. That you can get how many tons from just
the amount of electrical input that we need is $30 per ton.
$30 per ton. That's really good. That's fantastic. Yeah. Wow.
Yeah. Okay. And so this is really going to lower the price, and it's not going to be sold for $30 a ton. It's going to be sold for a lot more than that, but it's going to lower the price and allow it to enter into markets it never could have gotten into before.
Yeah. Yeah. Making something like that affordable, like graphene, graphite. Yes. Okay. That's awesome.
Yes.
And that, are you actively involved in that research?
Oh yeah. We're actively involved. We're doing more on it all the time. We've started several companies around that, companies for each type of material that could be made by these flash joule heating techniques, companies to look at the soil remediation, companies to deal with the different types of toxic materials that there could be that are generated. So we just look at the problems that humans have generated, and we try to solve those problems. And these are solvable. I mean, and we're looking at CO2 capture in very robust ways, really large amounts of carbon dioxide, and just leveraging what the planet does for us already, and leveraging that to help us to remove more carbon dioxide. Now, we don't want to remove it all, but if people say that carbon dioxide is an existential threat, if they really believe that, then we need some serious ways to go about doing this. And in my opinion, the serious ways to go about doing this are not trying to decrease the exhaust from an automobile or capture even what's coming out of a power plant. We need some really big methods to do this if it is an existential threat. And so we have to partner with the planet to do this. Now, again, there's a lot of controversy on these points, but we study these things that may be affecting humankind and human waste and human activity. And we say, can we do this more cleanly? And then we devise methods to do this. And like I said, I mean, we have three or four pharmaceutical companies we've started, several materials companies. I've got actually an electronic memory company that's gone public. So we work across a whole host of areas for building and construction and materials and pharmaceuticals and electronics. And that's a good thing about being a professor. You can kind of do anything you want to do as long as you can raise the money to do it.
Well, and you know, this is being a really good steward of the earth, and that's what we're called to do. You know, sometimes I think Christians they put too much of a negative connotation on environmental, ideas and trying to make things better for the environment. We had Dr. Paul Homan on, who does talk about the whole carbon dioxide is really being overblown. He's he was a lead meteorologist at the United States Air Force Academy, but he did talk about where he lives near an area where they were throwing garbage into the river and just polluting it and making life bad for everybody. So this is one of the ways we can be good stewards of the environment. And it sounds awesome what you're doing. So we'll offline, Dr. Tour, I'd like to get, links that you can give us to provide for people. If you have anything you'd like to share where they can go visit, find out more about this, but that's really neat. I appreciate that you're doing that.
Yeah, and I well know about the controversies on CO2, but like I said, I think these little things that we're doing are essentially nothing, and we're going to spend an awful lot of money. But there are ways to really suck up a lot of CO2 if you want to, and if it is an existential threat, if you really believe that, then we have to take big steps. And so, yeah, these are things that we're working on, and we want to take a sober view of these things, not just a reactionary view.
Okay. Well, Dr. Tour, we're almost out of time. I did want to thank you again for coming on Real Science Radio. And I really appreciate you had another YouTube short where you talk about how you shared Jesus Christ with somebody at Harvard, which is just neat that have those kind of opportunities. That's why you do your YouTube. That's why we have our show. We just want to get the truth out there and share, the love of Christ with other people and, bring about, as I say, try to bring about the fullness of the Gentiles, because the sooner we do that, the sooner we're out of here. So,
So,
oh, stop the tape. Stop the tape. I wanted to quickly air that 1 minute short that Dr. Tour just talked about, or that we just talked about in our interview. So let's air that now.
I was addressing a big group of people at an Ivy League university this week, and we were talking about origin of life, but for some reason I got zero scientific questions. People kept asking about my faith.
Or do you feel like uncomfortable because of your religious views?
So I didn't inject any religious convictions my talk.
That's true.
Okay.
But nevertheless, you have some. So.
I think it was because they were trying to use it as an excuse for my not going along with their nonsense proposals on origin of life. And at one point I said, look, my faith in Jesus Christ means more to me than anything. Now, there is a Christian guy there, wrote to me afterward, and he said, you never should have said that in a gathering like that. Made you sound like some fanatic. This is life. What I was giving them was life. What I was presenting to them was a way out. Somebody who's passionate about Jesus. I'll tell you, there is a narrow way that leads to life.
Praise the Lord. Fred, it's great to have a guy like Dr. Tour on our team. I mean, we don't have to agree on everything. We agree on the physical resurrection of Jesus Christ. We agree he's the Lord. We agree that he can save us. We agree that we just need to believe. It's an honor, and it's just awesome and humbling to know that we're on the same team of the same mighty, awesome creator God.
Exactly. And you know, Doug, so the interview finishes with him making an offer to anybody listening that they can call him if they have any questions about the resurrection of Christ, and he will talk them through it, and believes, you know, he hopes that within a minute of an explanation, he can convince them of the resurrection of Christ, which is really cool. So we'll go ahead and run the end of that interview that will take us to the end of the show. Is there any other final thoughts you'd like to share with us before we end this show?
Well, thank you for this opportunity, and thank you for getting the word out. And what I'd like to say is, if you do not believe in the physical resurrection of Jesus Christ, if you truly do not believe that, then send me an email to tour@drjamestour.org. tour@drjamestour.org. And we'll get together and give me an hour to share with you why I embrace that. And my guess is that you'll come out believing right after that hour. That's usually what happens.
Oh, that is so cool. Okay, well, again, thank you very much, Dr. Tour. It was a great honor having you on the show. So for my co-host, Doug McBurney, and Dr. James Tour, I'm Fred Blooms of Real Science Radio. May God bless you.